So was it a conscious decision to make like such an energetic record, or was it something that came organically, or?
It was a bit of a conscious decision because the previous album's called The Diving Board. And for me, that's probably the most intimate record I've made. It was mostly piano, bass and drums, and I loved it very much. But I thought the songs that I wrote on it were very, very intimate songs, and they weren't arena songs, and I play a lot of arenas. And to be honest with you, the two songs that I played off that album that I played in concert, people listen to them, but usually they're called The Toilet Break, and they would work in auditoriums or theatres. And I wanted to make a record that was happy. I felt in a happy mood. I was in Hawaii in January, and I phoned my guitarist. We were doing a show, and I said, Davey, I want to make an up-tempo record. I told Bernie to write up-tempo lyrics. Go out and buy some 12-string guitars. And I want this to be a rock record, more featuring the guitar than the piano. So it was preconceived. However, I've never really been that great at writing a lot of up-tempo songs together. So I was a bit nervous about it. And I suppose that helped me in the end because I knew I had to deliver. And at the end of the day, we came up with 10 tracks that they're not all rock and roll songs, but it's probably the most up-tempo album I've made since Rock of the Westies way, way back.
It made me wonder if it was a reaction, which you sort of answered, if it was a reaction to The Diving Board being more like contemplative and spare.
The Diving Board was kind of my nightclub album, which I loved, and it featured probably my best piano playing on an album because it was the featured instrument. When you're making a rock and roll record nowadays, the piano isn't a featured instrument. It's part of the equation. Yeah. And I got to use my band for the first time on this record for a long, long time. Yeah. And God, they stepped up to the plate and we had such a blast because they know where I'm coming from musically. I don't have to tell them what to play. They're just so in sync with me. And I think if you played with musicians, you know, if you're in a band, you guys know what to play, right?
Yeah.
And you've been around and you know each other. So I was very lucky. I'm very happy with it because I actually delivered what I set out to deliver.
All right, you've sort of answered my next question too, but I'm still going for it. You've been playing for decades now with Nigel and Davey, and were they thrilled or excited by this batch of songs in this direction? Because it can be such a physical thing, drumming and guitaring, and it sounds like they're really getting to flex on the record.
Well, they were delighted to be able to play on an album because it's frustrating. I made The Union with Leon Russell, and it was the first album I worked with T-Bone Burnett. On The Diving Board, I worked with Jay Belrose on drums and Raphael Sadiq on bass. And there was hardly any guitar on the record. It was just, we cut it as a threesome. So I think they were chomping at the bit because we've been playing so well live to play on a record. And when I asked them to play on a record, and T-Bone actually said, I'd like to use your band on this record. And I said, great, they'll be thrilled. And the funny thing is with Nigel, drummers are always like this. They get very nervous going to a studio because they really worry about their drum sound. That's the most important thing to the drummer is their drum sound.
Yeah.
And we set up 2 days beforehand and Nigel got a great drum sound. Well, the engineer got the great drum sound and Jason Wormer. Once Nigel got that, he was completely relaxed. And Dave has been with me for so long. They were just chomping at the bit to record. And the other guys too. And Ray Cooper came and played tambourine on it as well. So it's a bit like, yeah, this is the real Elton John band, how they sound at the moment. And it's really exciting because they really are a great band.
Yeah, after seeing you live, it makes a lot of sense to do, to make that move. And you said that was T-Bone's sort of idea. What is it about T-Bone Burnett that makes you keep calling him?
Because he's a musician and he knows, like all good producers, how to edit a song, how to choose the right moment to tell you that maybe you should think of doing it a different way.
Yeah.
Which sometimes hurts, as you know, because it's your song. It's like, but he says, you know what? I think you should do this and you should do that. I've always had the luxury of working with producers who have the balls to say that. And I've made 3 totally different albums with him now. I've made The Union, which was a duet album with Leon, and very kind of Americana. The Diving Board, which was a very nightclubby, and this one, which is total rock and roll. I think this is the most blatant rock and roll record he's ever made. It's certainly the most upfront, in-your-face record he's ever made like this. I pushed him, and he pushes me. And I think that's the way that a record producer and an artist should always work, pushing each other, trying to push the boundaries a little bit and make you a little uncomfortable into things you don't normally do. And I think that's why I really like working with him. He's open to all ideas.
That's good. Okay, so now for people who don't know, we all know the association between you and Bernie Taupin, but I don't think everybody really knows how, from the inception of a song, how does it start? Do you have a conversation with him and say, there are a couple of topics that I want to tackle, or does it come from him, his ideas, or how does that all start?
It's usually 99.9% always come from him. On this album, I said, listen, it's up tempo, and here's the brief. And he agreed with me. He said, you know, it's time to make a joyous record. Mm-hmm. And I think the record is joyous. I don't know what he's going to write. And when he gives it to me, and I go in the studio, and I didn't read the lyrics up front, I never do. I go in the studio with 20 lyrics, say, and then I look at the title of the song. First song we wrote on this album is called Blue Wonderful, because I love the title. And then you look at it and you think, what tempo is it going to be? It's a weird thing that I've never questioned. I have this instinctive thing when I look at his lyrics to know what's going to happen. And I talk about it in the show in Vegas. It's just an odd thing. But I don't question it, and I don't sort of try and examine it and, you know, think out, you know, try and go into why is this like this. It just happens, and it's always worked. And the element of surprise when I play him the finished article has never changed from the first song we've ever wrote to the one that we've currently done. So that keeps the relationship fresh, and the fact that we don't collaborate, yeah, I think has kept us really fresh.
That's good. Are there plans to tour the record?
We're going to be rehearsing the record in January in LA. And obviously, with this amount of up-tempo songs, we're going to try and include as many of them in the show as possible. Now, earlier in the interview, I said it's hard because bands like the Stones write up-tempo songs. And, you know, when you've got so many hits, and I'm not blowing my own trumpet, but people really want to come and hear the hits. We've already recorded two tracks on stage, Wonderful Crazy Night, which is the title of the album, and Looking Up, which is the first single. And they sound great. So there are three or four other songs. We'll just see. We'll experiment. We're going to do a showcase in Paris and see how it goes. Not just the rockers, but Blue Wonderful, I think, will be amazing on stage. And I also think A Good Heart, which is the ballad. So we've got a lot to choose from, which is more than I've had in the last few albums.
Great. So I guess to wrap it up here, a major part of your identity is that you are a masterclass songwriter and you're a larger-than-life performer. But how has now becoming a father changed your perspective on what it is to be successful?
Wow, that's a great question. Well, it's not all about me anymore. It's about the boys. I have two sons, Elijah and Zachary. My plan in my life now is try and take more time off to be with my boys. They don't really know. They know Rocket Man, they know Benny and the Jets, they know Don't Go Breaking My Heart, but they're more obsessed with other, you know, they've never been to a show, they don't, you know, I don't play them my new record. I don't think it's appropriate. I mean, they'll discover me when they discover me. They know what I do, but they couldn't care less.
Yeah.
Now, they like going on stage, but they only like to shine the torch. That's what they like to do. I wanted to make a joyous album because the feeling that I had when I thought about this album is that I'm in a really good space. I've got a wonderful husband. I've got a wonderful partner. I've got two beautiful boys. I've got a great career. I've got great friends. I'm sober. I'm clean. I've got everything that a 60 or 8 year old man could possibly wish for. You know, if I get depressed or I get blue, which every artist does or every person does, you get up some days and go, you don't know why you're feeling, but you are. And I spend 5 seconds with those kids. It all goes away. I've never had that kind of touchstone in my life before. It's a miracle what they can do for you. I'm in a great frame of mind, and the album's joyous because I'm joyous. And because I'm joyous is because of those children.